Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. I am Briareos Kerensky and welcome to the review of Fallen Legion. This game is available on the PlayStation 4 with the subtitle of Sins of an Empire and on the PlayStation Vita as Flames of Rebellion. Both versions play very close to each other and follow one unified storyline, but seen from different point of views. Before beginning, I must say that the developers, Yummy Yummy Tummy Games, offered me download codes for the two games, and I accepted to cover them only after being assured multiple times that they wanted a completely honest review. And here I am. And the game is good. Not without problems, but thoroughly enjoyable and a true labor of love. Both games are set in Fenumia, an empire barely held together through force. Cecile, the Emperor's daughter, is on the front lines to avoid the political intrigue of the capital, unwilling to bear the responsibility to rule the nation. With her stands Landur, the most prominent legatus, general, of the Fenumian army. The two are informed that the Emperor has died, and Cecile is given a talking book that flaunts to be the true source of power of the late Emperor. Cecile reluctantly accepts the scepter of new Empress and bolts towards the capital to seize power from the Council of Princes, a senate of sorts. Landur meanwhile heeds the suggestion of his two close advisors and starts a rebellion declaring himself Emperor. Cecile's storyline is told on the PS4, Landur's on the Vita.
That would be the last speech of its kind that I gave.
Lucia's blessing!
Both storylines merge at certain junctions and reach a common ending, although the resolution isn't particularly satisfying. In fact, the story is Fallen Legion's weakest point. Despite the developers' best efforts to build a complex world with a large pantheon, mythology, political intrigues, warring factions outside and within Fenumia, and a large cast of exclusive NPCs for both campaigns, nothing is explained outright. Loading screens offer a brief glimpse of this well-thought setting, but nothing is really fleshed out or properly introduced. For example, during the opening hours of Cecile's campaign, I was asked to side with one of two princes with no introduction of who they were or their plans. Later, I was notified that Iria and Soria were becoming hostile towards Fenumia. Only later the game informed me that Iria was a country and Soria was a ruler, when first faced with that subplot I had absolutely no idea of who or what they were. This problem is less evident in Landur's campaign due to a slightly smaller number of NPCs and the larger role his two top advisors play, but in both games I was often left wondering who or what I was siding with. This is particularly damning because Fallen Legion places great emphasis on players' choices. During stages, Cecile and Landur are faced with problems that can be solved in three different ways. These choices are linked to bonuses that will last for the current stage, and in the not-so-long run will affect the morale bar. These are only the two most visible effects of your choices, as choices will also determine NPCs encountered, their goodwill to give you items, ability to gain rare items, tidbits of information, secondary locations you can go, and even evolution paths for Cecile's and Landur's parties. Choices are vital in Fallen Legion, yet the game doesn't exactly build a solid foundation. I don't need to know everything about everyone in advance, but at the very least both Cecile and Landur will be knowledgeable about princes trying to get their favors or countries hostile to Fenumia. Instead, you are left in the dark, asked to make choices on the spot with little to no background. I must also mention that at times my choices felt irrelevant against the grand scheme of things and were only affecting the morale bar and character bonuses. Sins of an Empire and Flames of Rebellion play very similar to each other, the main difference being the main character and some of the spells they possess. Most enemies and bosses are shared between the two games, and between the two, Flames of Rebellion has the easiest introduction, but my perception might be skewed as I started it after completing Sins of an Empire. Cecil and Landur play the role of supporting spellcasters in battle, summoning up to 3 exemplars to do the actual fighting. Exemplars are personifications of legendary heroes brought forward by the power of the book Cecil was given in the beginning. Landur acquired the same abilities through a rather silly plot device. Rather than going for sheer numbers, Fallen Legion goes for a small selection of exemplars with wildly different abilities that only grow as both games go on. Exemplars are chosen before beginning a stage, each assigned to one of the face buttons. The main character is always controlled with the triangle button, with up and down on the D-pad shifting between the 3 available spells. An exemplar can attack up to 3 times before having to wait for their action points to recharge. Attacks will fill the combo bar at the bottom of the screen, and when an exemplar attacks at the rightmost slot, it will perform a death blow. The combo bar will reset to 0 if attacks are too far apart from each other or when one exemplar doesn't perform a perfect block against an incoming attack. Every single action, being it your exemplars or an enemy's, has its own wind-up time, and everything, even death blows, can be blocked with the right timing. Same goes for blocking, as it will cancel attacks charging up. Correct timing for attacks and blocks is vital, and with the whole game being in real time, this makes up for very intense and fun fights. At first everything will feel chaotic and very button-mashy, but after a couple of boss fights everything will be clear and become incredibly rewarding. Enemies also have a break bar that will deplete upon attacks, perfect blocks, and counter-attacks. Once depleted, enemies will be staggered. Kneel before your emperor. Against bosses, this leads to a brief moment where the boss falls to the ground and attacks are free. Bosses all have their patterns, and upon encountering them, Fallen Legion gives enough time to learn about their attacks, making almost every fight very fair and engaging. I say almost because one boss battle in particular is centered around perfect blocks and represents a serious difficulty spike that's never matched by anything else in the game, even by the final boss. At times battles become visually very busy, with the various effects and sprites hiding attacks that could lead to unpredictable hits on your party. This is usually countered by a relatively low damage output on the enemy's part, but at times I surely wished for less visual flair. Some attacks can also shift your party's formation, and getting it back to what you want is kinda dicey, as characters shift around based on the nature of their attacks, in addition to reacting to the enemy's offensive. A simple option in the pause menu or an indicator representing the current formation would have made things much easier to control. Exemplars are gathered by facing them in battle or through in-game events. As said before, their abilities vastly differ from each other, even when comparing similar exemplars like Dardanelles or Winchester. This is absolutely the best part of Fallen Legion. Exemplars can be mixed and matched to fully adapt to your playstyle, and the system is geared so that it's possible to complete every single fight with whatever formation. The ability to create your perfect party goes one step further when you get access to order and chaos variants of your exemplars. This shift is based, again, on your choices, and each variant is incredible on its own. Even exemplars left unused get their chance to evolve, and the absence of character levels, only your skills to control them, lets you experiment with all sorts of formation. I've settled with Zulfilkar as a tank, Dardanelles and Winchester geared up to do the maximum damage, but for example you could go with Dardanelles and their Gravity Embrace to clamp enemies together for Mjolnir to pummel, or do quick, frequent strikes with Longinus to have other exemplars deliver a constant stream of death blows. Possibilities might not be endless, but surely there is a lot to explore. Fallen Legion is a gorgeous looking game, with large, hand-drawn sprites and painted backgrounds that take more than one page from VanillaWare's titles. A few enemies and a lot of backgrounds seem taken straight from Dragon's Crown and Odin's Sphere, and while I appreciate every effort to keep 2D alive, especially now that hardware allows for huge and highly detailed sprites, in the end I'd have been more pleased if Yummy Yummy Tummy Games went for their own art style. Sins of an Empire on the PS4 runs at a constant 60 frames per second and represents the game at its technical best. On the other hand, Flames of Rebellion on the Vita suffers from a host of styling and technical problems. Art assets, including text and interface, appear to be simply scaled down from the PS4, resulting in muddier graphics with, at times, the text a couple of sizes too small. Some sprites aren't properly anti-aliased and stride with the rest. World map, terrain and backgrounds at times shows ugly junction lines between tiles. Keep in mind that I upscaled Vita footage to match the PS4's resolution for this review, so a few artifacts you see here might be exaggerated. But more damningly, almost every battle suffers from frame skips, not slowdowns, during the most intense moments. Seeing enemies and exemplars jumping from idling position to a successful attack is jarring and leads to unpredictable attack cancels and loss of combo bar status. These frame skips never led to an outright defeat or death on one of the exemplars, but after going through the game on the PS4 and its unwavering performance, playing on the Vita was almost painful as the battle system requires precise timings. Load times are also considerably longer, but at least they give you the time to read the in-game lore. The two halves of Fallen Legion, Sins of an Empire and Flames of Rebellion, are quality games and the developer's passion pours from every pore, despite them being at times too cryptic with information. Flames of Rebellion on the Vita suffers from severe performance problems, and splitting the story in two isn't something I'm very fond of. Fire Emblem Fates on the 3DS did the same, but at least if you wanted the whole game you didn't have to buy a new console for that. Both games offer a New Game Plus option along a One Life mode that forces players to restart from scratch if Cecile or Landur die, so there is plenty of replayability as well. Unfortunately, all game modes share one single, automated save slot. Sins of an Empire is absolutely recommended, Flames of Rebellion not so much due to its performance problems. I hope you have enjoyed this review and you'll stick around for more. Briarios Kerensky, over and out.
Ha 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 ha!